Here are various different videotape formats. Of course, there's standard full-size VHS. There's VHS-C, the compact version used in camcorders. There's Hi8, an 8mm tape format. Then there's Mini-DV, a digital video format also used in camcorders. But did you know that there's a videotape format even smaller than a microcassette? Yes, it's MicroMV. And if you've never heard of it, you're not alone. It was only on the market for 3 years, from 2001 to 2003, and only one company ever supported it, Sony. There's one of the camcorders which uses the format. That's the DCR-IP5 from 2002. Original list price, $1,100. For a size comparison, here's a digital still camera from 2002, Kodak, and you can see it's almost the same size. If I lay it down, the camcorder is just a little bit more chunky. So this was the smallest camcorder you could buy in 2002. You can record just over 1 hour of video on these tapes. It says 60 minutes, but it actually holds about 62 minutes. And it has microcassette memory, which means you can store title information on the cassette in a microchip. So as soon as you pop in the cassette, the camcorder will recognize your titles of what's on the tape without even needing to read the videotape through the mechanism. As the camcorder advertises, it records MPEG-2 video onto the tape, although this is MPEG transport stream because it's a tape instead of MPEG program stream used on flash memory camcorders. There's a stereo microphone on the top, 10x optical zoom lens. There's the infill lithium battery. It's the F type, which Sony no longer makes, although you can still get generic replacements. This one, of course, is totally dead because it's 12 years old, so it does not hold a charge anymore. There's your power switch, and this thing actually has a color viewfinder on it, which is really unusual to see on something so small. And here's the little flip-out LCD. And you can actually turn the backlight on or off on it. So if you're using it in bright sunlight, you just turn off the backlight and the ambient light will be enough to let you see what's on the screen. It also came with a remote control, the RMT817. And the funny thing is the charger is almost as big as the camcorder itself. So I'll need to plug that in to demonstrate it. There are the ports. The power input, AV input and output using a special connector which Sony still uses today, and the firewire port for connecting to your computer. There it is turned on. This thing has a very strange zoom control. That is the zoom lever. You wouldn't think it would work, but if you hold your finger on it and just push up or down, you can see it zooms in or out. So it does not seem to move at all, but just your finger pressure on it is what controls the zoom. And there's the start-stop recording button and a photo button for taking photos to the tape. The fancier models also had a memory stick slot for putting in one of those Sony cards and recording photos to it. And you can also record low-resolution videos to the memory stick. Here's Sony's original brochure for it, and there's a blatant lie on it. In the section about the MPEG-2 compression used by the MicroMV format, it says PC editing has never been easier. Well, that's only if you use the supplied software that came with the camcorder. Virtually anything else would not work with this camcorder format when it was new. It was not until MicroMV was pretty much obsolete that some of the video editing software finally started supporting it. It was supported in Pinnacle Studio versions 8 and 9. Versions 10 and newer dropped support for MicroMV. It was also supported in ULEAD Video Studio versions 7 through 9. Again, the newer versions dropped support for it. power director claims to support it even today, but I have not tried it. And Apple iMovie added support for MicroMV in iMovie 08, which makes you wonder why they waited so long. At that point, the format was already obsolete for 5 years before they finally started supporting it. But when these camcorders were new, there were endless complaints online about people not being able to use them with anything other than the movie shaker Windows software that Sony supplied with the camcorder. Here, I'll eject the tape from the camcorder. Just pop open the door like that. And it pops out. And there it is. The little MicroMV tape. And now I switched camcorders to show you the other camcorder I was using to record the first part of this video. I'm now using the DCR-IP5 that I demonstrated. And this is the one I was using before, the DCR-IP220. Here's the original brochure for it again. Claims to have a 2.1 megapixel CCD image sensor. And you can add an optional Bluetooth modem and connect it to the internet wirelessly. And Sony said you can even browse the web on this camcorder, but bear in mind that was the web according to 2002 standards, so I don't know if that would even work at all today. But that was definitely a feature way ahead of its time, because in 2002 Bluetooth was just barely catching on, even on cell phones. But here is that camcorder I was using, and you may have noticed that everything looked very close in that first part, because this has a very narrow angle lens. It's a 52 millimeter lens, whereas the one I'm using now has a 44 millimeter lens, which is still narrow angle compared to a 35 millimeter still camera, which is the standard by which those angles are judged. But one nice thing is that you get this manual control ring here, which can be used for either zoom or focus. And it also has night shot, which is one thing this other one I'm using now lacks. There's a stereo microphone on the top. And rather strange, the viewfinder is on the side and it's fixed. You can't pull it out or move it around. And even more strange is this LCD on the back here. There it is closed, and you pop it open. And you can either flip it up like that. You can flip it around to face the front in case you're recording yourself, or you can flip it back down like that onto there. And it is a touchscreen. There's your hand strap, and they even give you a stylus for the touchscreen. Pull it out of its little holder here, and there's the official Sony stylus for using the touchscreen. Also hiding behind the hand strap here are the ports. This time we get a USB port, a headphone port, LANC jack, and the FireWire port. There is no microphone port, unfortunately. On the top there's the power switch, the cassette eject button, the photo shutter button, and the zoom control, which is thankfully a real zoom control in this one. On the bottom is the battery hatch, and again on this one the battery is totally dead, so I'll need to find a replacement for it. You release that and it pops right out, and it's bigger in lithium F. 7.2 volts, 9.6 watt hours. Also on the bottom is the memory stick slot, and that's the older style of memory stick. I have one of those somewhere, but of course the one time I need it I can't find it. But it's bigger than the more modern memory stick Pro Duo, and of course the tripod mount. Now I have the camcorder plugged in and the orange light comes on to let you know it's charging, even though the battery is dead and won't take a charge. But we can eject our tape right on the top here. And that's the tape I recorded the first part of this video on. And again, Sony is the only one who ever supported this format, so you only ever will see Sony MicroMV tapes, not any other brand. They also gave you, with the camcorder, a cleaning tape. That's what it looks like. And they say do not rewind it, so once you use it up, you have to buy another one. And also discovered in the package with the brand new MicroMV tape the little tiny labels. Just look at that, the size of my finger next to those labels. You won't be able to write a whole lot on those. And you're supposed to fit that on that edge right there, right next to the right protect tab. Again, there's your size comparison between MicroMV and microcassette. Almost the same size, except the MicroMV is actually a little bit thinner. So it's actually a little tiny bit smaller than microcassette. Now, of course, these MicroMV camcorders were a complete failure in the marketplace. They were too expensive to justify the novelty of having such a small size, and this fancier model was actually not that much smaller than the regular mini DV cassette camcorders that were on the market at the time. So most people decide to just get a little bit bigger camcorder and have a much more common and much easier to edit videotape format than MicroMV. Because if you look up anything related to MicroMV, the first thing you'll come across is old forum posts from around 2002 and 2003 of people complaining that they can't get this format to work on their computer. And especially on this model here, Sony made some strange design choices that they never duplicated on any of their later camcorders for good reason. Especially this silly little folding and swiveling LCD and the viewfinder on the side that does not move. In terms of video quality, MicroMV is very comparable to Mini DV or Digital 8, especially this one with the 2 megapixel CCD image sensor. It takes nice, sharp, and clear video. Just the hassle of working with this format, which is what turned most people off of it. I switched camcorders again to show you this one again here, and here is how the LCD looks with the backlight turned off. So you can still see it once you have enough light shining on it. So that's good if you're out in the sun. That way it won't wash out. And this one is not a touchscreen. You have to use this little joystick here. The on-screen menus look like they should be a touchscreen. It looks like it has buttons that you should be able to push with your finger, but it's not. You have to use the joystick to go through them, which is rather clumsy. There's the option for widescreen. And you can see it just cuts off the top and bottom of the image. It does not expand it to the sides. So it's not a true widescreen. It'll record a 16:9 image on the tape, but it's just reducing the camcorder's field of view, which on this one is very bad because it's already rather limited field of view, and you make it even worse when you turn on the widescreen mode. And you also notice that even though I ejected the tape from this one to put it into the camcorder I'm using now, it's still showing the old time on the counter. That's because that's just a dummy counter. You have to remember to manually reset it to zero when you have the tape fully rewound. And then if you swap tapes, it is no longer accurate. So it's not a true time code like you get on mini DV or HDV camcorders. You also notice that sometimes when I change scenes, the image gets corrupted. That's not YouTube's fault. That's the camcorder doing that. Because every time you hit stop and then you hit start again, it just picks up again where it left off without regard to the way the MPEG-2 compression works. It does not issue what's known as a iframe every time you start recording, unlike HDV. So it starts recording of an incomplete image, which gets mixed together with the last image from the last scene when you hit stop, and that gives you a corrupted image until it gets to the next iframe. It's a very stupid decision. I don't know why they made it work this way. And on the camcorder, it covers it up by freezing the image until the corruption is over, but when you put it on your PC, you can see the way the image gets corrupted every time you hit stop and then you hit start again. Now, since I'm using this fancier model, I might as well give you a sample of how well the night shot works. It's not totally dark in here, but it is very low lighting. In fact, I'll turn off my last light on this side. And it works reasonably well. Not as good as some of the high 8 camcorders of night shot, but it does a decent enough job. There you can see how it makes all the indicators on the display visible. You can see right into the remote sensor there too. It also has super night shot, which slows down the shutter speed but makes the image much brighter in very dark areas. Now going back to regular night shot, you can see it gets darker but the motion is much smoother now compared to with super night shot turned on. It gets very smeary. This model also has a pop-out flash, which I forgot to show you for taking photos, but it does not have any kind of visible LED to help when taking video. You only get the night shot. So Sony called MicroMV the next big thing. Well, the only big thing it turned out to be is a big flop. Only lasted 2.5 years, pretty much. In fact, Sony announced they were going to discontinue support for MicroMV about 2 months before they released the final model that supported it, the DCR-IP1, which at the time was the smallest camcorder of any format. And these days, if you're looking for that movie shaker software that these camcorders originally came with, you cannot find it. Sony does not have it on their website, and I can't find it anywhere else to download. So what I'm using to capture MicroMV video on my computer is a freeware program called CAP-DVHS. It was originally designed to work with digital VHS, which is another obscure and little known and little used format. And I think NJ Roadfan should do a video about it because he actually owns a d-vhs VCR. But this works fine with MicroMV. You can see it even recognizes the camcorder by its exact model number. And if I just start playing here on the camcorder, this is some of the video it came with. Some kid's birthday party and stuff like that. And I hit record on here. It starts saving it to a file on the computer. You can see the video is 720 by 480. Standard definition resolution. 12 megabits. Okay, we got our birthday video captured. Can it stop now? And the audio is 256 kilobits per second MP2, 48 kilohertz. Now here's our video played with VLC. And once you have your video captured from tape onto the computer, you can use it with anything that supports MPEG-2 format. In this case, I'm using Sony Vegas to edit this video.
Maybe next time.
I hope so.